Let's talk today about the journey for Artemi Panarin, because he recently did an interview where he gave a few quotes as to his path to becoming what is one of the most valuable players in the entire NHL. Earlier yesterday, he was announced as a finalist for the Ted Lindsay Trophy, which is the NHL's most outstanding player as voted on by the NHLPA people. Alongside of Nathan MacKinnon on the Colorado Avalanche and Leon Draisaitl of the Edmonton Oilers, Panarin suits up as one of the three finalists, and the ultimate results as to who wins will be revealed at a later date. But for the most part, nobody is really surprised to see that Panarin has gotten this recognition amongst the NHLPA. The guy has been in contention for all these awards, and people have been saying that Panarin should even be a Hart candidate as well because of what he did for the New York Rangers this past season. Most of us know the story of Panarin. He came over to Chicago, he was traded to Columbus, then he left in free agency and went to the New York Rangers. But this interview with the New York Rangers star winger goes over a few of his thoughts as to his own path, and a lot of this is quite funny, I'm gonna be honest. Take a look at this. This is Artemi Panarin on his journey to becoming an elite NHL player. I would like to thank all the GMs for not choosing me in the draft, because it allowed me to choose the team where I wanted to play, that played my style of hockey, and allowed me to be successful to begin with. That's a big thank you. It's quite backhanded and satirical in a way, because normally when people say thank you for these awards and these nominations, it's always the same, like, I want to thank the coaches that I've played with, I want to thank the coaching staff in junior who helped develop me, I want to thank the NHL staff for believing in me and trusting me, but Panarin is like, no, I want to thank all the NHL GMs for not taking me in the draft. That's funny. In fact, it's not surprising to see these comments coming out of Panarin. If you take a look at this article over here from lowhud.com, talking about what some of the Rangers personnel are saying about Panarin, as he has just been awarded a Ted Lindsay nomination, take a look at this over here. This is at the halfway mark of the article. Panarin is not overly loud in the dressing room, but when he says something, a lot of the time, he's got a very dry sense of humor, teammate Chris Kreider said. He's witty. He's a little bit sarcastic, and he's sharp as a tack, but he's a very good teammate. He competes like a dog on the puck in games. He wants to win. He's highly, highly competitive. I mean, you could see that today from the scrimmage. Him and Mika Zibanejad going back and forth a few times. He wants the puck. Just to go over a lot of the timeline over here, because I do want to kind of touch on the actual draft story for Panarin, as well as how he became this good in the first place. Because he was born in October of 1991, his draft year would have been the 2009-2010 season. Since he has the late birthday at the end of the year, he wouldn't have been eligible until the 2010 NHL Entry Draft, and in that year in 2009-2010, he had 44 points in 38 MHL games and 9 points in 20 KHL games. For a guy who was 18 the majority of that year, it's certainly interesting to see why there wasn't any NHL interest here. It's not every day you see a draft-eligible first-year player playing 20 games in the KHL and just being at half a point a game at that. Even his next season as an 18-19-year-old, he maintained that presence, getting 21 points in 40 games played for the Vityaz Chekhov. He was so good that he was on the Russian U-20 World Juniors team, where he had 5 points in 7 games played. I remember he was playing alongside of Kuznetsov and Tarasenko for a good portion of those games, and that was a really, really good combo. Tarasenko and Kuznetsov were also players who were taken around this time at the NHL draft. Tarasenko in the 2010 NHL entry draft, and Kuznetsov also in that 2010 draft. So Panarin was supposed to be there too, but he just wasn't taken. Despite the fact that Tarasenko and Kuznetsov, who were also in that same draft year, had pretty similar numbers to Panarin in the KHL. They were all playing in that league, and they were all around the same points per game. But Panarin, after not getting drafted twice, he ended up not getting drafted a third time, and then a fourth time, and then a fifth time, eventually becoming a top scoring player for the SKA St. Petersburg hockey team by the time he was 22, 23 years old. Once 2014-2015 came along, Artemi Panarin was one of the top scorers in the entire KHL as a guy who was 23 for the majority of the year. He then established that he wanted to go to the NHL, and this is when a lot of NHL teams were saying, okay, this is going to be great. This Panera bread guy looks like he could become a really good NHL point producer. Back then, there wasn't really too much uncertainty when it came to signing big-name KHL free agents, top scorers in that league who wanted to make the transition to the NHL. We have that somewhat now because we saw situations like Vadim Chipachev with the Vegas Golden Knights, where he signed and he wasn't really given the opportunities and he wasn't really all that great, as well as Jan Kovér with the New York Islanders. But back then, Panarin was one of the first guys to actually want to make this transition. So you could see why there was a lot of NHL interest with this player. So once it was announced that the Chicago Blackhawks, who were coming off of, what, 3 Stanley Cups in the most previous 6 years worth of gameplay, signed him, the whole league was really frustrated. How the heck is it Chicago? It's always Chicago that ends up winning and getting these good things happening to their team. And man, Artemi Panarin as a 24-year-old scored 77 points in 80 games played in his first NHL season. He won the Calder Trophy that year, even though his points per game was not as good as Connor McDavid's. It's just because Connor McDavid missed out on half the year that he got really pulled back in the Calder voting. Not to mention Shane Gostisbehere, who was there in that year's worth of Calder voting. I remember making a YouTube video about that all the way back in 2016. And I was talking about it like, you know what? I don't think Panarin is going to win it because he was so old and McDavid was so young and he was just so, so skilled at such a young age. It's just Artemi Panarin's season was better than Connor McDavid's season, and that's the whole point of the Calder, to determine whose season amongst all the rookies was the best season. McDavid's just wasn't as good as Panarin because the longevity wasn't there and the total points put up wasn't there either. I was actually cheering for Shane Gostisbehere back then because I wanted the underdog college defenseman who came out of nowhere with the Flyers to actually do some damage out there, and to be fair, he did beat McDavid in the voting, which is awesome to see. But he didn't end up winning it, which isn't a surprise, but you know, you gotta do what you gotta do. Panarin was the guy who won that trophy, and now we are, what, 4 years removed from that, and now he got 95 points in 69 games with the New York Rangers. This guy willed the New York Rangers into a play-in series position. This team was supposed to be in a rebuild, but then everything just kind of came together at the right time. Adam Fox gets traded to your team because your team is the only one that Fox wants to sign with, one of the top NCAA defensemen in the most previous seasons. Tony DeAngelo's offensive side that he had in junior started showing itself off greatly this past season. Not to mention Mika Zibanejad's awakening into becoming an elite, borderline franchise NHL goal scorer. A guy who was one of the best goal scorers in this entire league, if I might say. Not to mention the young guys getting added on the team like Kaapo Kakko, Igor Shesterkin, Filip Chytil, not to mention Vitali Kravtsov, who looks like he has some work to get done, but he's still a young guy who is valuable for sure. And now with Panarin topping everything off in the cake, you have what could be seen as the leader of this big revelation in New York. A team that was not supposed to be this good, but who became this good because of a few standout performances, particularly on those off the stick of Artemi Panarin. Seriously, 95 divided by 69 multiplied by 82, he was on pace for 113 points! That is nuts! This guy would have been on pace, if we do the math for the goals, he would have been on pace for 38 goals. And however many gosh darn assists that would have been if you subtracted 113 from that. The whole free agent frenzy thing with Panarin was kinda ridiculous in terms of the speculation and in terms of who people thought Panarin should sign with. But furthermore, it's kind of evident that now, that 11-something million dollar cap hit that the guy has, man, it's pretty worth it. He is legitimately one of the best players in this entire league. At 28 years old, we've got so much time left for Panarin to show himself off at the best of his ability in this hockey league, and he's got to thank all the NHL GMs for not drafting him to allow him to be in this position. going back to Chris Kreider's comments, hey man, sharp as a tack. He's got a witty, dry sense of humor, and I love to see that. It's always the Russians that seem to have this kind of sense of humor, not to mention Alex Ovechkin and his weird way of talking about things as well. It's certainly beloved to see, and honestly, I love seeing this kind of stuff. So talk to me in the comments below what you think about Artemi Panarin, his whole story, and his claims right here as to why things went the way they did, because nobody in the NHL believed in him, which allowed him to go his own way and develop his own path. I hope you enjoyed this video. Social Network 99, and bye.